You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined. This is the first quick turnaround episode of the season. This has been recorded on Monday and it's going to go out on Friday as you're watching this. I am joined by the owner, proprietor of Grassroots Wrestling Scotland. Sorry, co-owner. I don't think Matt would be happy if I just went full all-in owner. I'm joined by Sammie Jo. Welcome to the show.
Hello.
It rhymed. That's fine. It must be true. I asked you off air, but off air like I'm a radio host here. But how's it going?
All right. Just as we say, busy. It's show week. Got to get everything out there this week.
Yeah. And Battle of Bannockburn. The Battle of Bannockburn is coming as people are listening to this tomorrow. So if you haven't got a ticket yet, hopefully they're sold out by now, but there may still be some limited available. But we will talk about that at some point during this ramble for the next who knows how long. But we'll get a bit of backstory of Grassroots Wrestling Scotland, which is why we're really here for. Before I do that, though, I want to find out a bit more about Sammie Jo. So we'll do that first. Go for it.
You know, from previously, I was wrestling through Source Wrestling. Unfortunately, they're no longer with us. But before that, after COVID and things, so fell away from wrestling, obviously due to COVID, working in the NHS kind of ran me down quite a bit through that. And then, was it a year and a half ago, me and Matt, well, Matt mostly, took the plunge and just went, do you know what? We're going to start something up. We want somewhere that anybody feels welcome to come and train. And then it started off as just training facility, and then the shows started sneaking in as well. So we've just kind of kept the ball rolling with that, because if you're training, you need something to look forward to, and we want to give trainees something to work towards for spots on shows and things. So why not?
Absolutely. So for yourself, I've got noted down in Cage Match, your debut was like 2016. So as far as being a wrestling fan, though, how did that begin? How did you get into wrestling?
Me and my brothers used to throw each other off of bunk beds when we were young. That was before the days of don't try this at home kind of thing. So I was brought up on the Attitude Era. Wasn't all that keen on the way women were represented in wrestling. I'm like mega feminist. When I started wrestling, I kind of always made a point of I didn't ever want to be put in like matches like that. They're not for everybody, but they're not for me. So and I was always treated as an equal to the guys in wrestling as well. I had more matches against guys than I did females when I was wrestling. But yeah, Attitude Era, The Rock, Lita. I'm a big fan of Lita, the Hardy Boys. Not that you'd tell that with my own wrestling. And then once I started looking further into wrestling, I'm a huge fan of old school World of Sport. I absolutely love watching old reruns of World of Sport and your older style stuff. So I like a lot of that.
We're talking about the Don't Try This at Home. Yeah, I remember those days. I used to do it at school, and then I left school and it came up with Don't Try This at Home or at school. And I was like, ha, loophole.
Yes, so you'd throw the mattresses off the bunk beds, and then the brothers would go off the bunk beds as well. So yeah, it was surprised I'm still walking.
I'm not teaching my son anything because I'm not qualified to do so, but he's 18 months old, and I've taught, he's got this like 2-3 foot Iggle Piggle thing.
Yes.
And I've taught him that if he throws it down and lands on it and he does a three count, it is the cutest thing in the world. And
even our kids were younger as well. So yeah, kind of keep wrestling out of this house.
I bet. So favourites, then you said that The Rock, Lita, big Hardy Boys fan in this house as well. I'm noticing my internet is going to come up as unstable, so in case there may be bits where I just like pause for you. Hardy Boys fan in this house as well. Again, wouldn't tell because I've definitely not the shape of any of the Hardys or Lita. So what was it, Source, that you went to initially, or was there anywhere beforehand?
No, walked through the door at Source. I got stuck in traffic, I'll never forget it. I said, I'm going to go. And then I did go, I got stuck on the M8, the car park that is the M8 every day. And I think I showed up about half an hour late to my very first class, and I got given a deck of cards and got told to work through it. And it just went from there. And then I was training 3-4 times a week for when I started. And then, as you said, I made my debut in 2016. So,
I mean, what a debut if it's correct. A showcase show. It was your teaming with the now Piper Niven.
Yes.
Which is not bad. She's done all right for herself, you know, in the States. She's done okay. What was it like making your debut then? What was the, were you ready? Did you feel like you're ready? Were you nervous? What was the whole?
I'd been pushing for it. So I'd been training since 2014 and I'd been asking. And I remember I had my very first training match and I'd made an absolute cowp of it. It wasn't the best. But that was my learning opportunity. So I don't see anything as like failing as such. It's always like, oh no, you learn from it, you move on and you get better. So I did that and then I just kept pushing and pushing and pushing. And I was in the shape of my life before my debut as well. So I just kept working at it. Had the showcase and then I think was on Fierce Females at St. Luke's after that as well.
I was going through your cage match profile anyway that we've got here, and to see the names that you faced over that time, the Source era, we'll call it, is insane going forward. Like Isla Dawn's in there, Alexis Falcon's in there for Fierce Females. We've got Veda Scott, Debbie Keitel. It's a very much a who's who of British and Irish wrestling, and Veda Scott's in there as well, who does a lot of things like commentary in the UK now as well. It must be a wild. It's very condensed as well in the amount of time it was, but over 4 years you condensed all these big matches in. How just for highlights, was there any particular matches that kind of stood out of going, oh my god, why am I, how have I got this opportunity, or this match that I've enjoyed?
Probably the one down in Liverpool with Debbie Keitel. Absolutely loved that. It was just shenanigans. Like, I don't know if you've seen any of the footage of it. When we brought out like the massive Costa coffee cup and we were kind of worked around that. So absolutely loved my match with Debbie. The one with Veda Scott. When I was told about that opportunity, and I'm not going to lie, I was absolutely petrified, but I got through it. So I was very, very happy with that. A few matches I've had against previously Courtney, now Isla Dawn. Absolutely loved working with her. We did a lot of kind of private training together as well. And obviously trained through as well with Nikki, previously Nikki Storm. Just absolutely couldn't believe it, but as well been given things like championship opportunities against, like for the Scottish junior heavyweight, I was only, I think, the only female to ever contend for that, and things like that. So yeah, it was just, I worked hard for it, I'm not going to lie, I worked hard for it. I'm not trying to be like big headed, but I worked and I worked and I worked, and to get the opportunities you have to work for it. So that's what I did.
So you working up and down the country as well. You said Liverpool. You were up north for Caithness, Pro Wrestling when it was about. It's now Combat League. A lot of traveling, a lot of wrestling, and listen, the litany of opponents that you're in with is just unreal as well, and what they've gone forward to do. The match with Debbie Keitel, was that you said drank pasta. Was that the one where she picked up and drank it and went, it's tea? And that's it. I've seen that clip.
Coffee? So it was worked out because I don't like coffee at all. I'm a massive tea jenny, or a tea snob, as I like to say. So we would work it around that, because I used to get slagged rotten for going to Costa Coffee and just asking for tea. So
I'll make it better for you. I don't drink either, so if I go to Costa Coffee, I get hot chocolate because I'm a child. That's yes. How it's been quoted as. I am a child.
The massive Costa Coffee cup was actually my oldest Halloween costume that year. So so that's it. So we just done it that way. It was funny.
So 2018, I had a couple matches with Matt. I don't think one will stick into your mind the most. Will be the the one at, I'm just trying to find the date in front of me here, because I made notes, but of course they're just all haphazard. November 2018, Source Live in Lennoxton, ended in no contest.
Yes.
For an interesting reason, though, if you want to tell the story. Oh, there we go. For the video, everyone knows now.
Ended up in a no contest with a marriage proposal, which is out there for the world to see. So it's all over the internet.
I mean, as someone who's loved wrestling since as far as they can remember, that must be like up there as just must be like the most you and Matt thing that could possibly happen. It had to be in the middle of wrestling.
We met wrestling as well. So we met in 2014. It was just kind of full circle moment. Definitely not expected, clearly. And still going strong.
That's the most important thing. It also led to one of the more surreal matches in your life as well, which was the I Do match with Emily Hayden.
I loved it.
Which introduced the world to Toasty, I think, if I remember rightly. Yeah. It was a wedding gift from Simon Cassidy and Sean McLaughlin.
Yes, it was. I absolutely loved that match. Me and Emily had kind of a good kind of working up to that match, and just the back and forth, even the social media stuff. Like back then, I had no confidence in doing promos, social media. I hated doing promos. Anytime I was asked to do a promo, if you look back, I'm not actually talking in promos. It's like we kind of kept it. Photos and storybooks and things like that, because I couldn't talk in front of cameras. I was very, very nervous about that. But that got me out of my comfort zone with that, and just daft things like going out wedding shopping and then the I Do match. And it was just random things like, what's the most cliched wedding gift you could get? Toaster. And that's where Toasty was born. So
wrestling's weird, isn't it? It's in the best possible way.
I absolutely love that match, and that's up there. That's definitely up there as probably my favourite match I've ever done, definitely.
So going forward then, Chad, you're still wrestling on and off through Grassroots. when it came to a style, though, you said you're a fan of Hardy Boys, but that doesn't reflect your style. Was there anything particular that you tried to emulate or pick up on for your own wrestling?
Yeah, so I've never ever, my feet don't like leaving the ground, and that's just, I think just because I feel like I'm older than a lot of people in wrestling, but also I'm very aware of the prospect of injuries and things, and I'm just like, no, my feet don't leave the ground. But there was a Fierce Female show that I got my Brave Pills on. Who was I against for that one? I can't remember, but it was a show that JR had came to watch. I don't know if you were aware of that one.
I was not aware of that at all, no.
So WWE were in town, and we had a Fierce Female show on, and JR had actually came to watch the show, and we were all backstage, and who was I against?
Approximate year?
Probably on the run-up to the I Do match. So probably 2019.
Right. So cage match has got yourself versus Emily Hayden at Dark, and then it's against Emily I Do. So before that was Ruby Radley at the Shed.
Ruby Radley, that was it. Yeah. So I had my match against her, and there was rumours that he was going to come to the show. So everybody was a wee bit on edge, and then when we looked up into the balcony and we seen that he was actually there, I thought, oh no, I need to go and put out all the stops. So that was the first time I ever did like a swanton bomb. So that's the only Hardy-esque thing I've ever put in a match, because I thought, well, if you're going to show off, you show off in front of the big guns. So that's what I did. And then I just started hitting that in matches after that. So that got me over the fear.
I was looking at the card for that particular show, and you know, it's very telling because Isla Dawn, Millie McKenzie's in there, Charlie Evans, Valkyrie, who's now Lyra Valkyria, Debbie Keitel, Jayla Dark, and Viper. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
Danny Luna was in some shows as well.
So yeah, if there was any show that JR was going to pick out on, and it seemed very
very surreal afterwards as well, when you actually. Everyone was encouraged to go up and introduce ourselves and say hiya and get feedback from the matches and things. So it was just the early 2000s, me was just screaming, going, oh my God, this is somebody I've watched on telly for 20 years. Like, surreal.
Did you tell them that was the first time you'd hit, or are we just like playing it off like, yeah, I do that every time? Always do the swanton, mate. Don't worry about it.
A picture of me with them afterwards, and I'm literally purple. And I think it's from how hot it was, but also I was just beaming, absolutely beaming from it, because my face was literally purple.
So you're talking about that, like the fear of doing those dives, because yeah, you work in the NHS, so you've seen the yes. aftermaths of many, not just a wrestling injury, but injuries in general.
Yeah,
It seems like a terrifying mix because of that fear of seeing all these bones and whatever, and you watching.
Yeah, I don't see that side. I work in a different part.
Okay.
So I don't see all of that. But it's more, I think I'm very aware of, like, my day job is something I've worked a long time to get to as well. So I don't want, I want a nice healthy balance between wrestling and what I do as my day job as well. So.
Yeah, and you don't want to do your day job with a broken whatever or a sprained whatever. Yeah, exactly. So that makes sense. So that kind of, we've really, because I wouldn't spend a lot of time speaking about Grassroots, we've kind of just done your wrestling career, 15 minutes, which doesn't seem like that. That's
kind of my style now is more aimed towards the whole world of sports side. Mm-hmm. When I'm tying people up and pins and stuff like that, I like that side of it a lot better. Yeah.
So Grassroots, so pandemic hit, people did a lot of things. You're working in the health sector, you were probably working harder than any one of us. Myself, I got sent home this time last year, and well, this time 2020, and that's it. I haven't went back to the office since. So everyone did similar things, worked like yourself, made bread, Twitch, or did a podcast. You know, I picked this one. Was that point when obviously things were starting to open up again during that period? Was that when Matt had the idea of going, right, we need to create something that we're proud of, that we can get everyone involved with? Was it always just kind of ticking away before the pandemic? What was
about it before? So obviously with things that came out during that point as well. Which I don't really want to go into, but we're just like, I didn't return to wrestling training after that. Just as well, like, my health had took a bit of a downturn in a 2020, 2021, early 2022. So I wasn't able to wrestle at all, or exercise really. So that was quite tricky. And then I think Matt was struggling as well, because just the two of us, we kind of got comfy, so to speak. and then kind of 2022 is where he kind of started thinking about it. And I was like, I'm obviously going to support him with everything, but I was like, well, we need to make sure the house comes first, blah, 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 family, things like that. And then it did become financially feasible. And then we just went for it. We just thought, if we're not going to do it now, we'll never do it. So, and that's where it came from.
So we won't get into the weeds as the hows and whys, because it's not a fun subject to speak about in any way. But It was a very weird time in wrestling where there was a bit of a disarray of where to go and where you can go, what's safe, what isn't safe, and not just because of the pandemic and because of other factors as well. So what I noticed, Grassroots Pop-Up came up with the app initially. That was the first thing I saw of Grassroots, which was something that I don't think any other company does or has, or if they do, it's possibly just students only. You get access once you join. So what was the app for? What was the app idea?
So I made that app. I'm not very technological, but apparently over the last couple of years, my technology working side's kind of getting a bit better. But it was more when you did wrestling training, you booked your classes through Facebook groups, social media, and I was trying to pull away from the social media side of things. Because from before, you would always have, I'm not booking in for training because such and such is booked in. And I wanted to eradicate all of that. So you could anonymously book in. The only person that has access to it is myself. Or obviously GDPR, all that, the legal side of things, because I'm holding people's information. But I wanted to get rid of that. I'm not training when that person's training. You just come in, you train, you go home. Everybody works together. We don't have cliques as such at Grassroots either now because of that. But I think it's just to kind of streamline as well, where it's only one person that's got access. There's no social media at all when it comes to discussing issues anything with regards to like upcoming shows. I would rather kind of keep that in private groups or through email. So I've went a bit old school with it. We're pulling it back that way. But when it comes to the app, I wanted people to see kind of what we had on offer and what we wanted to give back to wrestling. So we had made a pledge with the PPG, which had kind of came out after all that stuff as well. And we made a pledge that we wanted to provide a safe, welcoming atmosphere that anyone could feel comfortable in. And that's what we've done.
So a lot of the social media, well, say don't use social media, but you're very keen on using Facebook just to show what else is on offer. Things like make sure facilities are available, clean, and everything that you possibly could need is going to be there as well. When it came to getting the ring, because is the ring set up the whole time, or is it taken up and down when classes are on? How's that?
Previously it was set up all the time, but we're helping out a couple of local businesses, kind of fitness classes and things, where they can come in and use the place as a studio. So me and Matt take down the ring on a Sunday after the kids' class, because we've got kids' classes as well. And then it goes back up a Wednesday night for wrestling Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So, and that's to help out other local businesses who were looking for premises but were out of their price range. So we've kind of got an agreement with a couple of locals with that as well. So we've got people coming in doing yoga classes, Zumba classes. We've turned it into a wee studio, so it's quite cosy now.
So when it came to, so you got the ring and everything's kind of taken to be in that respect. I've never used that phrase before in my life. I don't know why I've decided to use it now. But you also went out and did galas as well.
Yes.
Working with the Ravy Davies Glasgow School of Wrestling a little bit. I was noticing through the students in there. Was that important for you to start getting out and forging these relationships with other promotions again to help with that inclusivity and get away from that stigma of you can't work here, can't do that kind of thing?
Absolutely. So we're working, got good contact with obviously Glasgow School of Wrestling and Attitude Pro Wrestling. It's kind of, we didn't ever want to go, you can't work here. We don't want that. That's not what we want. At the end of the day, wrestlers are independent contractors. Do what you want. We're not there to tell people where to make their money. That's not us. And we'll never do that. So yeah, like work as well. Like Davey's running shows everywhere, every weekend, and he's providing really good opportunities for people. And what he's doing over at Glasgow School of Wrestling is amazing. Like he's now making a full-time wage out of wrestling, which is amazing, which would have been unheard of a few years ago. So good on him. And then working with Attitude Pro Wrestling as well is good as well. I absolutely love it. And yeah, it's just working together.
That's it. I mean, I think in that respect, a lot of people do come to me. I say a lot. A couple of people come to me when see what we feature on our website and everything like that. It's like, oh, why don't you do this? Why do you feature them if they work here? And I'm just like, you know what? That's not mm-hmm. my issue. It's like, I won't feature these promotions. That's it. If you work for them, all right. Mm-hmm. I'd rather you didn't. But you know, it's not my. I'm not paying you. So just do what you need to do. If you can put your morals aside a little bit to do something to help an opportunity, you know, that's you. I'm not judging you mm-hmm. for that. Well, it sounds like I am. I'm a little bit. But yeah. So just do what you need to do if you want to make a full time job of it. So mm-hmm. it's the crap side of wrestling that I've somehow found myself dragged into.
Trying not to have. So that's how we're just trying to be as inclusive as possible as well when it comes to people training. So yeah, it's working. It is working and it's building.
So we got to Out of the Ashes then. This is August 2023. So that's a big jump in time between the gala days and Out of the Ashes. So what made you decide to go, right, we've done the galas, we've got this training facility going, we've got I haven't even mentioned who's on the training team. We'll speak about that first before we speak about Out of the Ashes, actually. So yeah, building your team, building your Avengers team for Grassroots. What was the process between that? Was yourself and Matt, obviously.
So I was in at the early stages. It was Matt and Manlin. So we're still very close friends with Manlin. And he had jumped at the opportunity to do training. He's always wanted to help folk at training at wrestling, and he's a brilliant teacher. So he had came on board. We did have other people or another person agree, which fell through. So it was kind of Matt and Manlin to start with. I've only just recently started coming in with helping with the training side of things. And that's again, we've had kind of a lot more interest from females for wrestling training and just for being appropriate to have a female member on the training team to make those people feel more comfortable as well.
Yeah, so Out of Ashes then. So that was August 2023 in Lennoxton at Campsie Memorial Hall. You mentioned it just kind of spiraled, but was Lennoxton obviously it was a source ground for a long time as well. Was that a venue you knew, so you knew that you knew how it worked, or what was the reason behind the first local show and for then?
Yeah, well, it's local to us as well. So so we wanted to, when we did the galas, we'd always had Out of the Ashes was already planned before the galas. We'd been working away on the background for that before the gala days. And there was a local charity that we wanted to help raise money for, again, down to personal reasons. We wanted to raise money for Rookie Rockstars. And Rookie Rockstars are a charity that support children and young people with mental health. They provide counselling services, and they also provide after-school music lessons and things. But the counselling side of it, the Rookie Minds, we'd heard was quite underfunded and a lot of people had to pay for counselling, and there's loads of people waiting for counselling that couldn't afford it. And we had kind of looked at them a few years ago with regards to one of our children, and we couldn't do it at that point. And we said, if there's ever a way we can raise money to help children whose parents couldn't afford it, then we would do that. And that's what Out of the Ashes was. So we did that for them. And between that and the gala days, we raised, was it £1,250 for that charity, which will provide free counselling for a good number of kids. So that's what we did it for.
Yeah.
So we wanted to go with a bang, and that's... and the charity to reap the benefits of that, and it was a brilliant show. Absolutely loved it.
I'm just looking at the match card here. So there's very much a Source vibe to it with the things like the scramble as well. And there's also a little bit of Fierce Females vibe to it because you brought in the Internet Championship, which is a little bit ironic with you trying to step away from social media, but we've got Internet Championship. But we will underthink that. We won't dive into that too much. Bringing titles in though, Internet Championship being the first one, Brody Adler against yourself.
Yes.
Was it important to make sure that you had something to fight for? What was the reason behind the bringing in the women's internet title being the first championship in Grassroots?
So it was all about equality again. Like the Internet Championship, again, it's the Internet Women's Championship, because I still feel as if there are some places out there that it's not as equal as others. And when Matt was building Grassroots and always said, like, women's matches, we need to have them, they need to be there, there shouldn't be a match card without a women's match. Like, and that's the wife coming out there a wee bit to say that's never going to happen. Just something to fight for, so that any woman who comes to wrestle with Grassroots, that they're always going to get an opportunity for something. So, and again, because I spent so long wrestling men in wrestling, we kind of wanted to level that out a bit, because a lot of women aren't comfortable wrestling men as well, and vice versa. So we just wanted to make sure it was always going to be a level playing field. And the Grassroots Wrestling Championship was gifted to us as well. So that was actually a surprise. We didn't know about that. And that was a surprise. So, yeah, that was good.
But I understand what you're saying about, but it's all about nowadays that yeah, you should be able to wrestle everyone. But you're saying, people don't want to, and you should need to respect that as well, kind of thing. It's I think it was Scotty Totty recently came out with that, going, oh, I've said I don't wrestle women, I don't feel comfortable doing that because I've got a daughter, and then somehow the internet decided, oh no, Scotty Totty hates women. And like, no, that's not what he said. That's oh god, I hate the internet, and yet I'm on it constantly. So but still on that same show, like I say, brought the kind of Source vibe with the scramble. So with you two being so heavily through Source, was that always the kind of mindset you had, kind of try and keep it simple for what you know, and then bring in these little things as it comes along?
So Matt kind of does more of the booking side of things. I'm the behind the scenes with the finances and the books and the
grown up stuff.
I do all the background stuff. He does the match booking. So I'm not taking any credit for the match booking. That's all him. So he has a specific style of match that he likes, and he's quite happy to try different styles of matches and things as well. So I'm sitting here with the match card for Bannockburn in front of me, looking through, and it's a match booking.
I think that kind of works a little bit more in our favour then.
Have fun doing as well. Like, I've been in the scramble matches before, and they're the matches you had the most fun, and because they were chaos, and it's a bit of chaos is fun.
I was going to say, that kind of works in our favour then, if we're going through the card then, because some of the matches you may look at and go, I don't know why that's there, or that, because it's all Matt's in charge of it. So that helps a little bit of the chaos when we're speaking about the card itself. Let's just go into that. So you got the Grassroots Championship as well, which was won by Ravy Davey. He won he won a Rumble, but I don't have the match in front of me, which is annoying me.
So that would have been the Rookie Rockstars Rumble. We did that
right at the bottom of the screen. I didn't scroll all the way down. That was the issue there. But yes. So I'm just looking to see who was on the card, and it's again a nice little tribute to yourselves, your journeys, because you've got the likes of Glasgow School of Wrestling guys in there as well. You got some guys from Source, of course, and then some of the guys from way up north, as well. So like a little bit of a Matt's little love letter to his wrestling journey that he's been able to throw as many opponents as he could in there, because you don't see RJ Cash outside of Keith.
And he's so good. His character's brilliant.
The matches are up on YouTube, their last two seasons, and I was a little bit lukewarm with RJ Cash, but as the shows are going on, well, I hate him, but yeah. That's good, you know. He's getting the right reaction. How it should be. Anyway, right, let's go for it. Battle of Bannockburn. Let's get the card in front of me here. So for those that are unaware,
I'll get the card up also. So
for those that are unaware and listening to this, it will be happening tomorrow, March 30th. Doors open at 6 p.m. bell time, 6:30 at Miner Social Club in Bannockburn.
Yep.
Tickets hopefully will not be available, but if they are, they'll be at eventbrite.co.uk. You can go on to Grassroots social media and find out more.
There's a code still on the go as well. So there's a wee code for Easter weekend still running for that as well.
There's a wee QR on all the posters as well. So it's all up to date and in with the technological advancements that I'm still refusing. I mean, when I see the podcast going out, other people's podcasts, they've got backgrounds and all that kind of stuff and the wee black bars above, I'm like, no. I've got Windows Movie Maker that's from the year 2004. That's all I need. Good. So yeah, big card here. I'm looking through it again. That nice little bit of source stuff and a little bit of everything in between as well. So we'll just start from the top. We'll go with your match first. Or I say your match. It's a mysterious woman called Samara.
Not a lot of people have seen Samara. Samara is Sammie Jo's alter ego.
I've seen a little bit of Samara, and there's like a spookiness to Samara, if I remember rightly.
I think Samara only came out for Respect Pro Wrestling back in the day. It was just kind of me trying to play with another character because everyone was used to sparkling Sammie Jo, and just to try something a wee bit different. So Samara's coming out on Saturday tomorrow. So yeah,
the guys at Respect were just like, "No, we're not cleaning up glitter again. You're gonna have to, you know, come back as someone else."
Samara does use glitter still.
Oh jeez.
Yeah, depends. Now I need to do the cleaning. I'm like.
Because the bane of a ringside crew's life, I guess, is glitter.
Or anybody wrestling after you, yeah.
So Samara will be taking on Nicole Jasmine, the current Archie Pro Wrestling Women's Champion, and she's everywhere at the moment. It seems up and down the country. So,
for a wee exclusive for yourself. That match will actually be for the Attitude Pro Wrestling Women's Championship.
Oh, so, there we go.
For you.
So Nicole Jasmine, who's she's everywhere. She's wrestled all manner of opponents, and fairly big names starting off with. So kind of mirroring how you were as well when you started, because she's in there with men, women. I was going to say children, but that would be.
No.
That'd be unethical probably at this moment. So a matchup an interesting one. So what were your thoughts when you were told that this match was happening?
She's worked hard for it. Like, she has worked. Like, I've followed her for a few years now. And I've seen how hard she's worked, and she deserves every opportunity going, because she's had her head down. She's worked and worked and worked and worked, and now that's all paying off for her. So why not? You work hard, you deserve everything.
She's very transparent in her career as well, which is probably why everyone really gets behind Nicole Jasmine, because she's put out her struggles. She's not fair to go, right, I've struggled with this and now I'm doing it kind of thing. And now she's coming in with a big belt. So that's not... And you're hoping that she will be leaving without it.
Hopefully. Definitely. So looking forward to that one. And let's see if I bring something new to the table after a few years as well.
So we've got a tag match. We've got Frankie Richards and the Big Strong Man taking on Manlin and Cobra Carr. So Cobra Carr, he took a big break in wrestling for a bit, and he came back when Grassroots returned as well. So I've seen a little bit of the promo. Manlin is as Manlin as possible.
I love him.
I don't know if this point, when this goes out, they will have a name. because that was seemed to be the topic of concern for trying to pick a name. But very interesting match. Frankie and Big Strong Man are two power dudes against the pure chaos of Manlin and Cobra Kai. He's got a little bit of power in him as well. So is this your meaty contest of the evening?
Frankie Richards and the Big Strong Man, they kind of left the last show. So when we had the show at the Gravity Suite in November last year, they kind of left bickering with each other, so to speak. Big Strong Man didn't agree with some of the match tactics that Frankie had, and they kind of left at each other's throats. So just need to wait and see what happens in that match, see whether they come together or whether they're still going to have a wee bit bubbling under the surface, and also see what if Manlin and Cobra can gel as a team as well.
Manlin, as Manlin is in charge of some of the training aspects. I remember rightly when I interviewed him way back when, that he likes a little bit of chaos with the hardcore elements of things. Has he already been dealt? No.
No. Well, we'll leave it for the show to speak for that one. But yes, Manlin's very known as loving his deathmatch wrestling. So we'll just need to wait and see what chaos he brings as well.
Well, speaking of chaos then, we'll go for the meat match, the Fatal 4-Way. We've got Big Ross Hauser, Darrow, who are usually known as Termination Z together, but they're in separate corners on this evening. Luke Matthews and TJ Smith. Or is it Smythe?
Smythe. Oh. He will tell you if you say that wrong. He definitely will.
I had it written down with the match announcement as Smith for a good 2 days, but nobody noticed, thankfully. And I went, oh no, there needs to be a Y. Needs to be a Y. God.
He will definitely tell you. There's big stakes up for grabs for that one. Putting Darrow and Big Ross against each other might make things a wee bit more interesting for that one. So that'll be for number one contender for the championship, that Fatal 4-Way. So it'll be loads of chaos. Luke Matthews has definitely, over the last couple of shows as well, feels hard done by. So he's definitely going to bring it to the table. And fight for what he thinks is right and TJ Smythe, yeah, he's just mouthy. Somebody just needs to shut him up, I'm not going to lie.
TJ Smythe is not one I'm familiar with. Was he through Source? Was he through...
Yeah. So back in the day, he tag teamed with Matt as the headliners. So if you go down that rabbit hole, you'll find loads of matches where him and Matt tagged together as well. And away back in the day, if you remember Celtic Arrow.
Yes, I remember Celtic Arrow.
Joe's got major training behind him. So that's, he's back pursuing what he loves as well. So but Joe's nice, TJ's not.
Remember it was Celtic Arrow, there was Tornado as well when I started getting into the Scottish wrestling scene. And then as soon as I went, oh, I like this Tornado guy, he stopped. And I was like, oh, okay. Great. That's my jinx working into effect there. Speaking of returns as well, or someone that's getting back into the saddle, we've got the three-way. We've got the Wanderer, Sammie D from Over the Top Wrestling, who's doing a seminar that day as well. So, again, for those that are unaware. And Robert Wishart.
Yes.
Of course, the former Solar. I think he's now starting to creep up on Terry Funk's record of retirements, but he is back after knee surgery.
I don't think he ever officially retired. He's just been kind of sidelined through injury. He had a major knee injury which required surgery as well. So this will be his first match back from that.
And he never signed the form to officially leave. He was he was always there in the background. An interesting concept of match, because you've got the Wanderer who's just again, a little bit of brawler, a little bit of chaos. If he ever gets to finish his song. You've got Robert Wishart, high flying, but with that knee injury, you've got that knee recovery, that's got to be a little bit of a factor in there. And then you've got Sammie D, who's got a wealth of experience and also big name opponents. I think he only just recently lost the OTT championship to Trent Seven. So this is a interesting match. You probably wouldn't think to have until you see it and go, all right, okay, I think this could be a bit interesting.
I think now, with the dark horse of the match card, I think, because I don't think anyone's known what to expect from this one. But the three of them will go out and do what they do best. And I think that'll be a match of the night contender, definitely.
Speaking of dark horse then, he segues professional. we've got the Dalen Hendry Invitational. We've got him with William Scott in his corner taking on a mystery opponent. I don't know if it'll be revealed by the time this comes out, but it could just be on the night. If you were to pick, actually, no, that, I think that sets unrealistic expectations if you're going to go Undertaker and then everyone's going Undertaker's facing Dalen Hendry. This could be amazing. He's a little bit of an attitude change since the closure of Source, and he's a very nice man now, is Dalen Hendry.
No, again, I think because he was the Source Wrestling champion, and then he had to relinquish that due to, I think it was injury. So I think Dalen's still got that being his bonnet of, I was champion and it was taken away from me before I got the chance to prove that I was worthy of it. So I think that's what's given him this attitude right now of, I was a champion, I'm now going to show you why I was that champion, and I'm going to go out and make myself a champion again. So I think that's where that new attitude came from.
So interesting to see if this kind of leads into whoever wins the Fatal 4-Way, if that's, because I mean, that'll just kind of bug Dalen even more, that someone will be in line to get the championship opportunity, and he's still waiting for it. So a very interesting concept there. Speaking of the championship then, because that's the last match I've got written down here, unless you sneak in some in between now and Friday. That little giggle meant possibly. But if not, Grassroots Wrestling Championship, Gravy Davey defends against Flying Ryan Griffin. So Ryan, he's been around the block quite a few times, former Scottish Junior Heavyweight Champion.
Yep.
He's still flying as well against Gravy Davey, who's this enigma in Scottish wrestling, it seems. He always brings some, he's like the Pied Piper of
absolutely folk. Quite literally on his shows as well.
I know, God, I don't know how he does it, because they came up to Peterhead for a show and it was just a different atmosphere. I don't know what Ravy Davy does.
He's just electric, he's absolutely electric, and there's no getting away from enjoying any of his shows. Like, you could be absolute diehard wrestling fan, like going to the indies, all of that, and you would enjoy a show, but you would get into that infective, I'm enjoying it because it's a good laugh, but appreciate wrestling at the same time. But as well, for the casual wrestling fan or the parents taking their kids to see wrestling shows, the parents are always sucked in with his shows, and it's great to watch. And that's just something that the rest of us can aspire to do.
And having him as your, I'm assuming, main event as well with the Grassroots Wrestling Championship against someone of the experience and stature of Ryan Griffin, who he seems to be out the other end of whatever darkness he was in the middle with his massive, I can't remember what it was called, a mace, big stick with the circle at the end. He did tell me. I'm going to say mace. But yeah, he seems to be a little bit more mellowed now in the world. He's back to his high-flying ways. It's going to be... When it came to... I mean, you can't... I said, Matt seems to do the booking. You do all the grown-up bits of can we afford them.
You can take all the credit for that side.
But when it came to bringing guys into the promotion, did you have kind of a say? Did you want a guy like Ryan? Did you want people that you've worked with in your show?
100%. There was loads of folk where we'd said, definitely, 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 we need to do shows with these guys. And the likes of, like when we brought in for Out of the Ashes, brought in Brody and the guys down for Keith Ness and things like that. That was a must do, like, cause they brought us up so many times, and I think it's only fair as well to repay the favour, but also give folk who don't get to come down this end for shows, get them to do that. But Ryan, very close relationship with Ryan, and yeah, definitely deserves everything. And I love his match style as well. Before I debuted, when I was refereeing, I've refereed loads of his matches against some crazy opponents, and I would always enjoy his matches, and the best seat in the house would be being ref for his matches. So,
but I mean, that's a hell of a main event as well. So that's six matches that have been announced as of us recording here. For those that are unaware, and you've somehow missed the point of me telling you at the start how to get tickets and what have you. Like I say, hopefully there's none available, but if there is, eventbrite.co.uk, doors open 6 p.m, 6:30 p.m. bell time, Miners Social Club of Bannockburn. Was there a particular reason for Bannockburn, or was it a venue that you
Ryan's hometown?
There we go.
He's the hometown hero. I don't know if you remember back in the day, Source had ran that once as well. It's a great venue. And we thought Flying Ryan, get him his homecoming as well if he's going for the title. And yeah, it just made sense. And we're trying to kind of just branch out that wee bit more as well, because a lot of the shows that we've done have just kind of been where we live, essentially. So we're just trying to branch out that wee bit.
Oh, that adds an extra little bit of thing for the main event then, because Ravy Davey, like I say, got the Pied Piper. He's got this massive following, and he's coming in against the hometown favourite. That's an atmosphere and a half that's going to be there. Am I remembering rightly that you was Out of the Ashes? You streamed it on, or was it the Gravity Suite show that you streamed on TikTok?
That was the Kirky show. So that was the one we did out of Gravity Suite. Mm-hmm. I've had TikTok is a nightmare. I'm not going to lie. I thought I would try it. I've had experience of TikTok live and stuff before, and it's very, very strict. It's really difficult to live stream anything on TikTok live because they shut you down. You say the wrong word, they'll shut you down. So I thought I'll try it. I wasn't wrestling on that show, so I was trying to kind of do a bit of both, get some post-match reactions and things. And it worked until the main event, and it cut me off in the middle of the main event. So I was raging. But we had, at one point, there was, what was it I said to the guys? It was about 3,500 people had eyes on that show.
Through TikTok.
So, yeah. I would like to do it again, but it's really difficult with TikTok Live to do that. But again, we want the people who have come into the show to get their value as well. Mm-hmm. It might be this time, it will just be wee sneaky snippets this time, rather than the full show. But I wanted to try it to see how it would go, because you don't know until you try it. TikTok's still very kind of, I'm trying to think of the word for it. It's volatile platform. Mm. Very picky with what it likes to put out there.
It's interesting, like when we mentioned the app thing way back, however minutes ago, it's trying new things that gets you away from your Facebook and all that kind of stuff, and TikTok is just as toxic probably if you dive deep, but it's just at least trying different things. I don't know if YouTube Live would be anything. I don't know, like say my technological advances is as far as this goes, and
because TikTok's up there as the number one social media platform in the world right now as well, so that's where people have eyes on things, and it was shown there on that show, so it's maybe something to think about, maybe doing wee snippets here and there, and then that way I could pull the footage from before and do wee snippets and put them up, kind of drip feeding that just now on TikTok. I'm trying to do kind of day in the life, get ready with me's, like the cliched TikTok stuff, and the run up to the show to kind of see what the inside runnings are for planning this, as well, so that people get to see the other side of it. It's not just, oh, here's a wrestling show, it's magicked out of thin air. I want folk to see the hard work side of it and the pressures of it as well.
That's the stuff I like. I mean, when I go to the wrestling shows, I just kind of switch off. I enjoy my 2-3 hours of wrestling, but that's the sort of bit I like as well. I like seeing how long it took. I mean, I've been lucky enough to be backstage at shows. With the pro shows it was with, probably not that lucky. But when I've been backstage at shows, it's just curious to see the ring being built and looking at it and going, oh man. And then later, seeing all people go, oh, laughing along and looking at the ring going, aye, but I see what's underneath there, and that's not fun. It's not fun to look at.
So I think I uploaded on TikTok yesterday, kind of come with me to a Sunday at grassroots wrestling training. And then so there's that, a wee kind of run up, and then I've done a time lapse at the end of us bringing the ring down. So it's quite interesting to kind of see that side of it as well. Because I've always said I wanted to do a time lapse, so, and I did it. So it's out there for the world to see now.
So you can go check it. We'll do all the social media plugs towards the end, just so you have time to get them up as well. So looking ahead, though, so we've got Battle of Bannockburn. That's happening. That's happening tomorrow, as I said, as this goes out. Is there a 5-year plan? Is there a plan to expand further? What's the kind of outlook for grassroots? Are you just taking it show at a time?
So over the summer, we've already been asked to return to galas and the canal festivals and things that we did last year, with I think there's a few more on the books for the summer, so it's going to be a busy summer. And then we've got our next show is going to be announced tomorrow at Bannockburn. I'm still working on a couple of bits and pieces for that, because apart from Out of the Ashes, I'm your poster designer, so so I'm still working on that a wee bit, but we've got big things planned for the next show, which will be in June as well. So it's a busy summer. We'll get through the summer and then kind of make a plan for autumn winter after that into 2025.
Excellent. So when it comes to bringing people in, again, just trying to make sure every shows are as inclusive as possible, at least get one women's match, get whatever. But if, forget Matt for a second, money is no object. You're not looking at the books. Is for you personally, is there anyone that you think, I want this person in grassroots at some point, whether it's UK, US, because the forbidden door is open. Is there anyone that you would love to see step through the doors at grassroots?
I'd love to see, well, I know, like, you're saying forget Matt, but his dream match has always been him versus The Miz, because it would just be absolute shenanigans. The Miz is one of his big idols, so if I had unlimited funds and full control, that would be my gift to him, would be him against The Miz, because that would be his dream match. For other folk, like, again, it's just getting folks' dream opponents in. Big fan of, before Finn Balor was Finn Balor, and his Fergal Devitt days, 100%, I would have him on a card any day as Prince Fergal back in the New Japan days and things. That would be my big booking. I don't know who I'd put him against. I'd need to probably do a death match to figure out who would get him.
So Manlin is what you're saying, is it?
probably, yeah. So, but I know Manlin is very big on, like, your CCW, things like that. So, he would I don't know. I don't watch that stuff, so I couldn't rhyme off an opponent for Manlin for that. But, yeah.
All that. Saying I could give you any opponent, and you didn't even think of yourself. You could have had you and Lita, you know. Yeah. But no.
Yeah, I don't know. I think you still got, I think you have to give yourself something to look forward to. And I think if I ever had to have my dream match with Lita, I'd need, that would be me done.
Fair enough. Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah.
Same kind of thing as if I ever get Drew on this podcast, Drew McIntyre, I think I'd probably just shut up off after that. It's like, I'm done. I have maxed out what I need to do. I'm going to go and, you know, see my son grow old instead. And I could just tell him, son, I interviewed Drew McIntyre once. There you go. Yep. It was 5 minutes, but it was the greatest 5 minutes of my life.
I had a good car journey with him once. See?
So... I'm still riding on seeing him at Rock and Wrestle. I went backstage. He wasn't even announced for the show. And he looked at me and went, hiya. And I went, hiya. What are you doing here?
Working with other promotions kind of through the years, and you've met your idols. Like, I've got pictures of my kids with Cody Rhodes, Drew, things like that. And it's just Billy Gunn. Like, I'm just like, what on earth have I done in my life? And when I look back on these things, and I'm going, wow, like, this is what wrestling's done. And that's the good side that we need to hold on to with that as well. This is the stuff that it gives you. But yeah, I'm saying, I've got a picture of my oldest. It must have been about 8 or something. And he's sitting, he's just, his face is lit up, him in a picture, a wee selfie, his first selfie with Cody Rhodes. And it was just amazing.
And to think that maybe in a week's time, or a week and a half's time, you could be sitting there going, you know what? That's you and the WWE champion there that's sitting there. Hopefully, and fingers crossed.
When you're wrestling on these indie shows and you're thinking, you never ever think, actually, like, for example, I've had my matches with Isla Dawn, and like, we always knew that she was going to go far, but it's not until they're there and you go, I've wrestled against these people who are on the telly. it's surreal.
That's exactly the same when I'm going back through photos. I've got a picture of Viper, and I think it blows my wife's mind more, because I've been in about this for what, over 10 years, 12 years I've been in about Scottish wrestling, and she's like watching Drew going, you've met Drew, you've traded DMs with Drew. I was like, yeah, it's weird. I will not deny that. And then you see Viper and the likes of Nikki, and we're very lucky in Scotland that when you think about the whole world when it comes to wrestling, that Scotland still has quite an influence over the world of American wrestling as well, and think that yourself and everyone else has played a small part in their development as well, and seeing where they went in the future. That's just, yeah, mind blowing. Unfortunately,
and the wrestling fan in you still going, oh my god, like trying to have a sense of professionalism, but at the same time, if you're doing professional wrestling, you've been a wrestling fan at some point in your life. So have your fan moments whilst you're enjoying it.
Take the picture. I think that's the key phrase.
That's my biggest regret, is not taking the pictures. All the pictures. Like, it's surreal. Like, when I think back, so I'm going, I've worked with such and such and such and such, and I never ever got pictures, and I should have.
Yeah, I will ever forget. Unfortunately, embarrassing moments that comes with it. But Billy Gunn, I got a picture with him, but my first sentence to him was, oh, I loved your whole career. Even something. I was like, why did I say even? Why did I just go, no, I liked all of it. Don't say even. Just don't point out something you didn't like. Smoking guns, probably. But yeah, it's just the worst things. Ricochet is still the worst one. Oh, hi, I'm Trevor. No, you're not.
Like, as well, like, I've been backstage at shows, like, as you said, Ricochet, when it was Scottish Wrestling Alliance, you had Ricochet, Will Ospreay coming in, Cody Rhodes, Billy Gunn. It was just crazy. Like, and then you had Devitt coming in. Crazy. It was just crazy, the people that you've met, and you need to pinch yourself sometimes.
Absolutely. I think we could probably spend an hour just trading back stories of, oh my god, I met this person once, and either I loved it, or I met Lita, and it was one of those Q&A things up in Aberdeen, and she asked, I got 8x10, signed it, and said, who do you want me to make out to for our book? So I've got our book as well. And I went, oh, just to Billy. It's okay. I'm not going to sell it.
just a nerves. It's just a nerves thing.
Absolutely. It's like this is the woman I fell in love with in 1999, and now I'm meeting her, and I'm like, just, oh, she loved my Hardy Boys t-shirt. Oh, that's cool. Yeah, I got it on eBay. I couldn't find one of yours. Oh, shut up. Just shut up. I need to leave now. Just go. I'm going. Anyway, so Grassroots Wrestling Scotland is coming up on Saturday. I was talking about the matches. You've talked about which match is possibly the dark horse, but for whatever reason, if there's still a couple of tickets left, final sell. Why? Why should people be going to Grassroots Wrestling Scotland?
Because it's definitely for all the family. Big kids will love it. Wee kids will love it. It's a family night. I know it's slap bang in the middle of the Easter weekend. But it's a family night out. Yeah, there's obviously the venue that we've chosen. There is the bar for the adults, and we'll have sweets and things for the wee ones as well. So it'll be a good night out for everybody. Get yourselves along and see what we're all about. Yeah, we'll have fun.
Perfect. So social medias then, how can people find out more about Grassroots Wrestling Scotland?
So we are on Facebook, Grassroots Wrestling Scotland. We're on TikTok. I think that's Grassroots Wrescott. I need to look it up because I'm really bad for remembering. Grassroots Wrestling Scott on TikTok, and on the place I don't really go to, Twitter, X, whatever you want to call it. We're on there also. And Instagram is Grassroots Wrestling Scotland as well. You'll find us, just search. Or it's all on the link tree on the Facebook. You'll get all the links to social medias.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. I know that you're wanting to get kept, so I'm going to let you go do that. And I will go and edit this and put it out so it's nice and looks like this, but maybe with an intro and outro. But no, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me.
Perfect. Thank you.